Books on Tape presents No Shortcuts to the Top, Climbing the World's 14 Highest Peaks by Ed Viesturs with David Roberts, read by Stephen Hoye. Chapter 1. Self-Arrest. At last, things seemed to be going our way. Inside our Camp 3 tent at 24,300 feet, Scott Fisher and I crawled into our sleeping bags and turned off our headlamps. The next day, we planned to climb up to Camp 4 at 26,000 feet. On the day after, we would get up in the middle of the night, put on all our clothing, grab our gear and a little food, and set off for the summit of K2 at 28,250 feet, the second highest mountain in the world. From Camp 4, the 2,250 vertical feet of snow, ice, and rock that would stretch between us and the top could take as long as 12 hours to climb, since neither Scott nor I was using supplemental oxygen. We had agreed that if we hadn't reached the summit by 2 p.m., we'd turn around, no matter what. It was the evening of August 3, 1992. 54 days earlier, we had started our hike into base camp on the Baltoro Glacier, which we had reached on June 21st. Before the trip, even in my most pessimistic scenario, I had never imagined that it could take us more than 6 weeks just to get in position for a summit push. But this expedition had seemed jinxed from the start. By hideous weather, by minor but consequential accidents, by an almost chaotic state of disorganization within our team. As usual, in the midst of a several-day summit push at high altitude, Scott and I were too keyed up to fall asleep. We tossed and turned in our sleeping bags. Then suddenly, around 10 p.m., the radio in our tent crackled to life. I turned on my headlamp, grabbed the walkie-talkie, and listened intently. The voice on the radio was that of Thor Keezer, another American, calling from Camp 4, 1,700 feet above us. "Hey, guys," Thor blurted out, his voice tense with alarm. "Chantal and Alex aren't back. I don't know where they are." I sighed in pure frustration. In the beam of my headlamp, I saw a kindred expression on Scott's face. Without exchanging a word, we knew what this meant. Our summit push was now on indefinite hold. Instead of moving up to Camp 4 to get into position, the next day we would find ourselves caught up in a search and possibly a rescue. The jinx was alive and well. On August 3rd, as Scott and I had made the long haul from base camp up to Camp 3, a grueling 7,000 feet of altitude gain, Thor Keezer, Chantal Modui, and Alexei Nikiforov had gone for the summit from Camp 4. Chantal, a very ambitious French alpinist, had originally been part of a Swiss team independent from ours. When all of her partners had thrown in the towel on the mountain and left for home, she had stayed on, illegally in terms of the permit system, and in effect grafted herself onto our group. She was now the only woman on the mountain. Alexei, or Alex, as we called him, was a Ukrainian member of the Russian quintet that made up the core of our team. That morning, Alex and Thor had set out at 5:30 a.m., Chantal not until 7. These starting times were much later than Scott and I would have been comfortable with, but the threesome had been delayed because of high winds. Remarkably, climbing without bottled oxygen, Chantal caught up with the men and surged past them. Struggling in the thin air, Thor turned back a few hundred feet below the summit, unwilling to get caught out in the dark. Chantal summited at 5 p.m., becoming only the fourth woman ever to climb K2. Alex topped out only after dark at 7 p.m. The proverbial 2 p.m. turnaround time isn't an ironclad rule on K2, or on Everest for that matter, but to reach the summit as late as Chantal and Alex did was asking for trouble. And trouble had now arrived. On the morning of August 4th, as Scott and I readied ourselves for the search and or rescue mission that would cancel our own summit bid, we got another radio call from Thor. The two missing climbers had finally showed up at Camp 4 at 7 in the morning, but they were in really bad shape. Chantal had been afraid to push her descent in the night and had bivouacked in the open at 27,500 feet. 3 hours later, Alex had found her and talked her into continuing the descent with him, possibly saving her life. Staggering through the night, the pair had managed to stay en route. No mean feat in the dark, given the confusing topography of K2's dome-shaped summit. But by the time they reached the tents at Camp 4, Chantal was suffering from snow blindness, a painful condition caused by leaving your goggles off for too long, even in cloudy weather. Ultraviolet rays burn the cornea, temporarily robbing you of your vision. Chantal was also utterly exhausted, and she thought she had frostbitten feet. In only marginally better shape, but determined to get down as fast as possible, Alex abandoned Chantal to Thor's safekeeping and pushed on toward our Camp 3. He just said bye-bye and took off. Thor himself was close to exhaustion from his previous day's effort, but on August 4th, he gamely set out to shepherd a played-out Chantal down the mountain. It's an almost impossible and incredibly dangerous task to get a person in that kind of shape down slopes and ridges that are no child's play for even the freshest climber. Thor had scrounged a 10-foot hank of rope from somewhere. That's all he had to belay Chantal with, and maybe to rappel. Over the radio to us, Thor had pleaded, "Hey, you guys, I might need some help to get her down." So Scott and I had made the only conscionable decision to go and help. As we were getting ready, we watched as Alex haltingly worked his way down the slope above, eventually stumbling toward camp. We went up a short distance to assist him, then helped him get into one of the tents, where we plied and plied him with liquid since he was severely dehydrated. Meanwhile, surprisingly, he didn't show any concern for Chantal. Going to the summit, both he and Chantal had pushed themselves over the edge, driven themselves to their very limits. It happens all the time on the highest mountains, but it's kind of ridiculous. To make matters worse, on August 4th, the snow conditions were atrocious. Same with the weather, zero visibility. Scott and I tried to go, made it up the slope for a couple of hours, then had to turn around and head back to camp. We made plans for another attempt the following day. We were in radio communication with Thor. He'd started to bring Chantal down to Camp 3, but he only got part way. They had to camp right in the middle of a steep slope, almost a bivouac, though Thor had been smart enough to bring a tent with him. The next day, August 5th, Scott and I got up, packed our gear, and started up again, hoping we could meet up with Thor and Chantal and help them back to our camp. At some point, we could see them through the mist and clouds, two little dots above. It was blowing hard, and little spindrift avalanches were coming down the slope we were climbing. Part of it was stuff Thor and Chantal were kicking off from way above, stuff that, by the time it got to us, was a little bigger, but no really big slides. I'd scrounged a 50-foot length of rope, with which Scott and I were tied together because of the crevasses that riddled the slope. At one point, Scott was above me. Something just didn't feel right. I yelled up to Scott, "Wait a minute, this is not a good slope." It was loaded, ready to avalanche. If you've done enough climbing, you can feel the load on a slope. I attribute that sense to the years of guiding I'd done by that point in my life. At that time, Scott hadn't done as much guiding as I had. We stopped in our tracks. I said, "Man, let's not get ourselves killed doing this. Let's discuss this." Scott sat down, facing out, looking down at me. I figured if a big spindrift slide came down now, we're going to get washed off the face. I started digging a hole with my ice axe, thinking I might protect myself if a slide came from above. After a few moments, I looked up just in time to see Scott engulfed by a wave of powder. He disappeared from sight. At once, I tucked into my hole and anchored myself, lying on top of my axe, the pick dug into the slope. Bracing myself for impact, I thought, "Here it comes." It got dark. It got quiet. I felt snow wash over my back. The lights literally went out. I hung on and hung on. And then the avalanche seemed to subside. I thought I'd saved myself. I thought, "Wow, my little trick worked." But the fact was, Scott had been blindsided. He was tumbling with the snow, getting swept down the face. He hurtled past me, out of control. Scott was a big guy, maybe 225 pounds. I weigh 165. The rope came tight. Boom! There was no way I could hold both of us. I got yanked out of my hole like getting yanked out of bed. I knew instantly what had happened. Scott was plummeting down the mountain.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.